If you say shit to yourself you'd never say to others, second guess yourself, and never had a healthy romantic relationship where you feel cherished and loved, I've got just the thing for you. Hi, I'm Barb Nangle, boundaries coach and three-time guest on the pod. If that's you, you have got to apply for Your Empowered Life. This is my 8-week transformational semi-private program for women so you can learn how to show up as the woman you've always wanted to be. You'll get tools to create healthy communication and relationships, feel like a sturdier woman who can say no without a flood of guilt and shame. You'll learn how to create satisfying, healthy relationships with yourself and others, and trust yourself. If you want to be authentic with yourself and others and no longer worry about what others think of you, this program is for you. Apply by March 20th at higherpowercc.com/empoweredlife or at the link in the show notes.
Success as a therapist is not found in doing something for the client, but rather in being someone for the client. My name is Andrea, and this is Adult Child. Welcome back to Adult Child, where we take a deep dive into the impact of growing up in a dysfunctional family. Ahoy, my dear shit shows. Shit show nation. For any new listeners, my name is Andrea. I am a total shit show. And if you're wondering whether or not you're an adult child, let's see if any of these are applicable to you. You stay in toxic relationships way past their due date. You have a hard time setting boundaries. You feel guilty when you say no. You feel a sense of responsibility for others at the expense of your own well-being. You are constantly seeking praise and recognitions from others, but then you can't accept a compliment. You are afraid of authority figures. You find it hard to trust others and build healthy relationships. You have a hard time expressing your emotions and identifying your needs. You have a hard time navigating adult responsibilities. You are addicted to negative excitement. So I would say if two or more of those are applicable to you, you're in the right place. Welcome aboard this hot mess of a ship. So today we have a first. We are diving deep with a trauma therapist, Mike Pinkston, and his former client, Kenny Weiss. So I had Kenny on the podcast, I guess it was like a month ago. He is a coach. He is a YouTuber. He is an author. He is a fellow shit show whose healing journey began 20 years ago when he stepped foot in Mike's office for the very first time. And not only was Mike, you know, instrumental in Kenny's healing journey, he also was very influential in Kenny shifting careers into being a coach and helping others. So Mike is a licensed professional counselor. He is in Colorado Springs. He has a million bajillion years of experience of helping shit shows like us. And he spent his most recent part of his career specializing in neurofeedback. And I was thinking, I think the only time that neurofeedback has come up on the podcast was in Kenny's episode. Like, I don't think that we've actually dove into this modality at all. And it seems to be an effective modality for treating trauma. So we probably should have covered it by now, but better late than never. So Mike's going to tell us all about neurofeedback. We're also going to get to hear about him, his childhood, his healing journey. And we're going to get to hear the two of them recount their experience of working together. I think that Kenny saw Mike as a therapist for, I want to say, 9 years. So it's fascinating. It's really interesting to hear the unique perspective of the client and the therapist. It's a goodie. So let's just get the damn show on the road. But first, let's talk about why you, yes, you need to damn the Joy and Shit Show. This is my online support community where I host 4 weekly Zoom support groups. This is where you can connect with other fellow shit shows. Some profound healing and profound fun happening in this damn community. You're missing out. Cut the crap. Enough already. Damn the Join Shit Show, okay? See the link in the show notes to join. Next, give me a little follow on the Insta, on the TikTok, at Adult Child Pod. And last but not least, give me a damn 5-star rating on Apple, on Spotify. Thank you. Love you all. Mm-hmm. All right, y'all. You're in for a damn treat. We have returning guest, fellow shit show, coach, author, Kenny Weiss, and his, how do you refer to him as? Your guardian angel, your lifesaver, your role model.
Those are good ones. Now I call him my friend.
And friend.
Yeah, man, I love. Therapist, mentor, teacher, mother and father I never had. And the only person who's decided to learn everything about me and loves me anyway.
The man known as Mike Pinkston, licensed professional counselor, neurofeedback expert, and executive director of Heart Matters. Anything else you want to throw in there?
That I'm a QEGDL.
Yeah. What? Can you please tell me what that stands for?
And QEG, is that what you're asking? What is QEG? Mm-hmm. Well, do you want to wait for neurofeedback before we talk about that?
Okay, sure. I'll be on my toes. This is suspense.
I'll bring it back.
Okay. So this is where I want to start. You said this when I interviewed you before, Kenny, and then you also say it in your book, when you walked into his office and you said, I just don't know how to be a man.
Yeah.
And then you replied, Mike, something along the effects of like, you know, I once was in your shoes, and what I did is I went and became an expert in it. So I want the backstory to that.
Well, sort of the backstory of, and Kenny, you can.
No, I want the backstory of your life, of you getting up to that point. I was once in your shoes, and then I became and get an expert. Explain.
That's a really long story. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's it's
longer.
You
got big ears, Michael.
Well, I can ask you this, Mike. This is typically where I start with people, is at what point in your life did you realize that your childhood impacted you a lot more than you thought it did?
In my 30s. So mid-30s. So long story short, I grew up in an abusive home, a violent home, a sexually abusive home. I have two older siblings. I was the protector in our home when my dad would get drunk and go off on somebody. And we got out of there eventually. I mean, I am skipping over stuff. But so then I go to college, and you know, I don't know what I want to do. I had 9 majors in my first 2 years. And part of that is, you know, there's no direction in a home like what I grew up in. So, you know, you're making it up as you go. And that doesn't bid well for, you know, feeling mature and growing up. And so, again, long story short, I went to graduate school. And about a year after graduate school, my wife, who was an attorney, filed for divorce. And that literally broke me. And
pause. What's the significance of including who was an attorney?
Well, she did all the legal work, which basically means she got everything, but it doesn't matter. I would have given her everything. I thought it was all my fault because I respected her so much. And I guess I still do. I don't know her now. I haven't known her for almost 4 years, but it really broke me. And that's when I started really working on myself. And eventually I found PM Melody. I wasn't doing counseling. I was in the oil business for a while. And then I started doing counseling again. And, you know, Pia's concept is that we have adult bodies, but we're children inside. And so that's where the idea that I could grow up and I could face, you know, my traumas and get real about it. Again, I'm cutting out, you know, I'm editing as I go. But so I started a process, and I started a process, you know, I did survivors workshops with Pia and with another therapist in Fort Worth, Texas. And by that time I had met my bride, and we've been married for 38 years. And a lot of the desire or motivation was that I had no idea, you know, I knew how to be a friend to teenagers, and I married teenagers. So when I got married, I had 11, 13, and 15 year olds. And And I didn't know how to really be a father. And that was also a big motivation for, you know, going to my first survivors, because I did not want to, you know, even though I'm, you know, I was a counselor, I was trained, all this stuff, you know, I'd get triggered by my kids, mm-hmm. and my youngest in particular, and because he's a lot like me. Mm-hmm. And so I knew I just didn't want to, I didn't want to have another wreck of a marriage. And so I, there was an incident that I had with my youngest son. He hit me, and then I saw that as an opportunity to throw him across the room, which I didn't do, but I was about to. Mm-hmm. And in the midst of that, I had him over my head and I sat him down and I said, look, what you just did was not okay, but I need to get help, and I'm going to get help, and I don't expect you to trust that. Mm-hmm. I just ask you to watch. Mm-hmm. And so that really started, you know, my very active recovery, going to therapy for 3 years. I went to AA, even though I'm not an alcoholic. I went to AA for 3 years, and just to listen. I needed to go to a place where I didn't talk, because if I talk, I'm going to, you know, manipulate the situation so that I'm kind of a leader of it. And, mm-hmm. or at least that's what I thought then. And I needed to just go listen. And I never said a word in 3 years at AA, but I heard all kinds of people's hope, strength, and wisdom. And I needed people who were desperate. That I tried to go to Al-Anon, and I'm not saying anything negative about Al-Anon, but I needed to hear desperate people, because mm-hmm. I felt very desperate. Mm-hmm. And I think also I needed to see people do what my father didn't do. That is, you know, get into Sorry. Recovery. And he did quit drinking, but it had a lot more to do with that. He was in a mental hospital for 8 years, so after all that. So that started a process, a therapeutic process, and a 12-step process, and, you know, just a personal process. You know, one of the things that when I was thinking about, you know, it was several years before I thought about another relationship. But once I thought about a relationship, I wanted someone who was as committed to growth and change and maturing as I was. And I certainly found her, and she's led me in many ways in that regard. And I don't know, ask me something else. I ran out.
When you were talking, it reminded me, I went to my first AA meeting with my mom when I was 12, and I said, hi, I'm Andrea, and I don't want to be an alcoholic. And then I was in rehab like less than a year and a half later.
Wow.
I just, when you were just talking about the incident with your kids, and just how much I hear, you know, how much gets triggered once people have kids, and realizing what you didn't get, you know, like realizing how you were treated, and like never imagining like that you could treat your kid that way. I always think it's really courageous and brave of when people talk about, like, you know, like I want to be physically violent with my kids, you know, cause like that's something that's real. And a lot of people have a ton of shame about, but is, I think, a lot more common than people say, especially for those of us who grew up, you know, in a dysfunctional family. So I guess it's, you know, it's in romance and in child rearing that this shit really shows its head.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've often said, well, the hardest thing I think to do in life is, between either working on yourself to a point of growing up, or doing a marriage, and then there's raising kids. And none of those are easy processes. I mean, they take a lot of effort, a lot of purposefulness, I mean, you're right. If you grow up in trauma, I mean, that was the thing with when I became a father, as opposed to being a friend. I worked with Young Life for 30 plus years, and so I knew how to be friends with kids, but I wasn't, you know, I wasn't responsible for them or thing like that. With my kids, I felt responsible, and I wanted to also model a relationship with them. And I think eventually both Patty and I, Patty's my wife, I think we both accomplished our goals with our kids, but for me, it was Trigger City. Mm-hmm. You know, my son walked in the house and he slammed the door open when he walked, if he isn't upset about something. And that's what my dad did. And so, you know, I'd be hypervigilant and I'd be jumping. What I say to my clients now is, you know, hypervigilant. We don't want hypervigilance. We want vigilance. Mm. Hypervigilance means we jump to a conclusion. Usually we're wrong. And, mm-hmm. you know, part of that is the PTSD mm-hmm. reaction. And so that, you know, that's what would happen. And until that incident, and then, like I said, I went to my first survivors. It's not survivors of sexual abuse. I did not know I was sexually abused when I went to that thing.
When did that come? When did those repressed memories come up?
That first meeting.
Okay.
But I had covert, I knew.
Mm-hmm.
I did not know about, you know, overt things. And that did was something, you know, I wasn't going into looking for that. I was looking for how do I get rid of this anger and this feeling of just being a little kid inside who can't defend himself and has to. And so when you hear your story from other people, there's no blinders on it. You know, you don't have the defenses to defend for them, but you can feel what they're feeling. And that's what happened. And that's when it got my time to work, that's what came up. And, you know, I had primary memories, of that. But they were just a little different, you know, mm-hmm. they were edited mm-hmm. in my head. And they weren't edited when I saw it. So, and so I, you know, I worked on that. And, you know, my big motivation were the things that I said that I wanted in my wife. I wanted, you know, I became committed to growth and change, and I became committed to growing up. And so I did identify with Kenny. Wasn't like I was, you know, his guru or anything like that. We just walked together, and, you know, learning how to be an adult and such.
What year was your first appointment, Kenny?
It was December of 2004.
Wow, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
How far into your journey were you, Mike, at that point? Like, how long had it been since you went to that first survivor's retreat?
Oh, at least I did the survivors, I think, around 1988. So,
okay.
I was in it by mm-hmm. the time he was there.
And
we were, you know, it was the only time that I really was a subcontractor for a guy who did sex addiction. You know, the center was a sex addiction center, but I have always been drawn to trauma as a professional. Isn't that interesting? And complex cases. And so that's what Kenny was. He was a complex case. I'm just kidding.
He's a complex sex addict. A real nut job is basically what you're saying.
Yeah.
real fucked up. That's my type. The more fucked up, the better.
Well, if Mike were to be honest about his, you know, true biography and his, you know, CV, the certification, you take an hour just to read all the things he's done and become an expert in, you know, mm-hmm. like, it, you know, so yes, I fit all of those classifications very well.
50 of them.
And that doesn't make me bad. That just makes me human. I think most of us fit a lot of that.
Fuck yes.
You know,
I don't want to be just boring. The more fucked up, the better, my opinion.
I just think we minimize it. My personal opinion is we're just not in truth about it. And and if I can just pop in for a second, you can see why my life has changed. Mike just sharing, you know, these were our sessions. You know, Mike being open and vulnerable with his perfect imperfections, sharing his heart and his story. Well, you know, I'm sitting there as I listen to it, I have tears in my eyes because it just brings back so many memories of, you know, one of the biggest holes in my journey was my father wouldn't let me know who he was. My parents, I never got to know them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's what I needed. What do we all need? Intimacy, into me. And this is what one thing I learned, almost everything out of my mouth I learned from Mike. I think this came from him, is my memory, but intimacy is into me, I let you see. Mm-hmm. Well, that's what Mike's doing. Well, that's all I ever wanted. I think that's all any human wants. Mm-hmm. And so he modeled that for me. And I learned how to look into me to create intimacy, and then, you know, still working on generating it with others. So,
yeah, there was a line in your book. I wrote this one down because I wanted to say it. You said, if Mike had never shown how his story related to mine or shared his perfect imperfections with me, I would have never felt safe enough to be vulnerable and tell him my deepest, darkest secrets. Mike modeled a loving relationship and became the parent I never had until I could become a loving parent for myself. And it reminds me of, you know, I've asked many, you know, therapists, clinicians about like, what's the most important thing, like when it comes to finding a counselor or a therapist. And the answer I always get is like, it doesn't matter what the modality is. The most important thing is that you actually feel truly seen and heard and understood by the person you're sitting across from. And I think that that quote really exemplifies that.
Yeah, because my life, I think I had seen close to 10 therapists before Mike. Mm-hmm. I never learned a damn thing about him. Mm-hmm. And I think that's part of why I do this work, is I have a fundamental difference with what therapists, psychologists, and psychiatrists are taught. I think that's why people don't get help and don't achieve the results they're looking for, is because it's a top-down method and it resembles the parent-child dynamic where I'm above you. It's a false empowerment and there's this wall. Well, in my reality, which doesn't make me right, that's the problem. That wall needs to be broken, and we need someone to model maturity and moderation and sharing our pain without infecting somebody, and all that. It's a skill set, and that's life. That's what I learned, is that's relationship. And that's what Mike taught me, was, you know, this is what relationship looks like, because I had no clue. None.
Well, I think so many therapists haven't, like, there's that wall or that boundary because so many of them haven't done their own work. Like, you know, that's a large part of it too.
That's been my experience. Yeah. I, if I'm not mistaken, I think they've even removed that requirement. I think they used to do some personal work as part of their degree, but I think they...
That wasn't significant though. Ever.
Yeah.
Well, even if they do it, doesn't necessarily mean, like, I mean, there's a lot of subpar therapy. It doesn't mean they're actually getting down to the nitty gritty, you know?
I don't know about everybody. I can only speak from my experience, and what I've seen are the characteristic of people that go into this line of work. It's because they have childhood similar to Mike and myself. You know, there's trauma.
They want to fix other people.
They want to help other people, but
yeah,
which is wonderful. But what I've learned is, until you can become an expert in identifying and overcoming your own perfect imperfections and dysfunctions, you can't teach what you haven't lived. And so, you know, as I say, Mike was the one who pointed out, gosh, 2-3 months into our working together, because I was also going to a group that was part of this thing, and he'd get reports back, and every time I'd come in, he'd make comments. And then finally, it was somewhere in that 2-4 month range of just starting to work with him, he says, you have a gift, you need to come work for me. And that was the but thank God I didn't, because back then I thought I could actually heal people, and and I thought I was the source of their improvement. So luckily, you know, I spent, you know, the next, what, 10, 15 years working on myself before I ever started working with clients. And and that's unique. I don't know that that's a, you don't find people that have spent years on themselves before they ever start helping others. And so I may not have the degrees Mike has.
You got life experience.
But I've followed his example and tried to learn what I can. And so there are some areas I feel like I can speak to certain things that might be of help to certain people.
Mm-hmm. What about, so my therapist too, she, huge part in leading me to doing this. I know she was put in my life for a reason. One thing about her though, and it frustrates me, but I know that she's, I know that it's the right thing to do is, so we've been working together for like, I don't know, like 6 years. And, but like, you know, she does put those, keeps those boundaries in place, you know, to a certain extent. And I can't wait until we're like 20 years down the road where I can be like, can you just be my fucking friend? You know, but what about you, Mike? Like in those early times, like where did you have to be like cognizant of like having certain boundaries in place with Mike or with Kenny?
Yeah, but you need to understand, I was seeing eight patients a day.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't, I mean, that builds in boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because I got to go from him to somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And, but I think it's interesting when you were thinking, you know, I think in terms of therapists, you know, we have to have several skills or hats that we wear constantly. I mean, I think we have to be in tune with ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
and continuing a process of working on ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
We have to know how to regulate, especially in a therapeutic situation. I heard that statement by a master therapist. Her name is Sabern Fisher. She does neurofeedback and she works with Bessel van der Kolk. And, you know, she's a master, but she said, you know, basically part of our job is learning to regulate, not react to you know, whatever we're hearing and, mm-hmm. and that kind of stuff. And I think we also have to be pathfinders or, you know, the guy that goes out in front of everybody, you know, and what is that called, Kenny? you know, the guy in the wagon train, but he's out front and he's checking out the lay of the land and whatever that's called.
Here's how, do you want to hear how I explain it?
Sure. Please. No, actually, no, I'm kidding.
To me, the process reminds me of the Wizard of Oz and Dorothy. And she's standing there at the beginning of the Yellow Brick Road and she sees the rainbow and she knows that's her destiny. She knows it's what she's capable of, that she has that inside her. And she knows the road will lead her to it, the Yellow Brick Road. But it twists and turns. She can't see every aspect that'll get her there. And that's fearful. Even though she's certain, like I can get there and I know this road will take me there, but I'm really scared because I don't see every aspect of it. Well, to me, the role of someone like Mike and myself is we've walked that road and our job is to lay the golden bricks in front of her. As you know, as each client walks that process, it's like, no, I'm here. I'm with you, and here's the next brick for you to step on and move you down that path until you, you know, grasp that rainbow for yourself. And but it's allowing them to take the steps as slow or as fast as they want to go, and allowing them through sharing our experience, strength, and hope. The idea is they feel safe enough to go, okay, I believe you. And I because of your transparency, I believe you have walked this path. So, okay, I guess I will let you be my bricklayer. That's how I see it.
Bricklayer.
And you've got to walk to the road. I mean, you were talking about therapists that don't do their own work. You know, in my office, I have wonderful therapists. They've all done their own work. I mean, because I've done that work with them in the past. And it was just like, you know, I said to Kenny, he has a gift. I didn't say you're ready to be a therapist right now.
He didn't. He actually said you were special ed. Special, not a gift.
And so whoever, you know, is in that position on the Yellow Brick Road, they have, first of all, it takes courage to walk the Yellow Brick Road yourself. And then, you know, hopefully that person has walked it numerous times and they know all the crooks and crannies of that. But that's all I was going to say. You were going to ask a question.
I wanted to ask, and I want you to both answer this question. Can you give me a pivotal moment, like in a session? Like, can you remember something, Kenny, like a big breakthrough? And then Mike, I'd love for you to answer the question too.
I could list countless.
Give me one.
One of the first ones was, well, that comes to my mind at least, is we're talking about my sex addiction, and it was how Mike taught me about denial and self-deception. He paradoxed me. And so I was like, so what you're saying,
how did I do that so wisely?
We've talked about that. The problem is Mike forgets all of this because it just comes from his, I call your authentic self. But I've told him this story many times. But so we were talking about it. I'm like, well, wait a minute. You're telling me I can't hug a woman or kiss a woman or be intimate or have sex until we're married and all of that. And so in other words, I had gone down the victim road. You know, I dropped into the disempowered child and all of that. I didn't know that at the time. But this broke me open to see so much about myself. So much of what I've discovered since Mike comes from this moment. And instead of arguing with me or trying to convince me, he just sat there, he listened to me, he goes, well, maybe for you it'll be different. Maybe you'll. And so what he did is he completely pulled the rug out from under me being a victim, but he didn't tell me I was playing the victim. He allowed me to walk into the truth and see it for myself. And that's when I just like that. I
remember, you're like, fuck you, dude.
I just knew it. Totally.
You,
but,
Mike.
But instantly excited because it's truth. And that, one, that was like my, because my whole life was all deception. And so it's the first taste of like, that's the beauty. Everyone's afraid to do the work because, oh, it's going to hurt. But that's what truth does to you. It excites you. Because yes, you see, oh my God, look at all the things I had to admit to, manipulative and all of these things, victim oriented, da, 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 da. All the things none of us want to admit to. But the second you see it, you're free. And it's just that. You know, I teach truth, responsibility, healing, and forgiveness. And that one, when he did that, I can trace back to, you know, kind of the major focus of everything I teach goes back to how impactful that moment was, of how important truth is in doing this kind of work and the things I've discovered about how to paradox people and all of that stuff and how to paradox ourselves. You know, that's my latest book is really about here's how you do it. And that started from that question. And, you know, there's so many more. I could go on and on, but, you know, I'll let Mike respond to that.
Yeah, I'd love to. Let's hear one, Mike.
You know, Mike has a real hard time with that, remembering those moments. Yeah, because I'm in the moment. I'm not sitting there thinking, oh, let's say something cool. You know, I'm literally in the moment, and then the moment changes and I'm there. And so, you know, those are two different spots. And, you know, he's constantly reminding me of stuff that we talked about or something I said, and I don't remember saying it because it was, you know, it was a real moment. It wasn't, you know, this wasn't fake. This wasn't something that, you know, I had planned out. It was true relationship and responsiveness to, you know, the immediate situation. The one that came to mind, which I think, again, kind of demonstrates the idea twofold of being willing to go somewhere mm-hmm. with someone, which can be uncharted territory, and also staying regulated. And we had a exercise, it wasn't mine, it was the center I worked for, about emotion. And, you know, one of the things that's, you know, might be hard for you to know about Kenny is he wasn't always open. And he was scared to death of the things he felt and should have been. I mean, there was some real scary stuff he grew up with. And so we had this exercise where you had to just stay in your feelings. You remember that?
I remember many of those.
And it's kind of, you know, as a therapist, it can be asking for it because you don't know what you're going to get. You know, he might, you know, throw the pillows at me or come after me or what. You know, I have had clients attack me.
Physically?
Physically, yeah. Men. Well, I've had a couple women too. Anyway. But, you know, I had to be willing to go with him and let him be there. And I stay regulated to model that for him, which is different than shutting down. Oh,
this is Kiki.
Now I'm going to go get my puppies. Mm-hmm. but you hear what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. That's all I got. There were thousands of moments. Mm. We've known each other now for 20 years and there's even more since we kind of started
more of a friendship. Know,
our connection. We, you know, I always felt like that there was a level of friendship, not always, but, you know, after our first, several years together, but, yeah, he's a special guy. And then when we, you know, he called me and said, look, you know, it's COVID, you know, and we were alone and all the time. And, you know, I was feeling anxious too. He asked me if I'd be willing to meet with him and we, you know, basically be friends. And it kind of started, in my opinion, it kind of started like, you know, I'm the therapist, he's the client kind of thing. But soon it became equals, and then sometimes I'm his client. So,
what about Kenny? Can you remember a time like where you got really pissed off at him? Something he said?
Yeah, there was a time we did a lot of EMDR work together, so. And that was very helpful. But then I noticed my mind was able to, it wouldn't let me go there anymore, and I couldn't stop it from manipulating the situation. I remember one time I went into a rage, like you said, and I can't remember if I threw stuff, but I know I got up and, you know, was really angry, but it wasn't authentic. It was really a rage against myself because I couldn't stop myself from guarding myself. And the only way I learned to express myself was manipulatively. That was the skill my childhood taught me, and I was running up against it and couldn't. I think it's still something I struggle with. I can't, as much as I want it. I still have blocks around it. I can still see it. And it was funny, I was just thinking about it 5-10 minutes before this, how I can still guard myself, as Mike said, I still guard myself and I don't want to, but it's just a very learned pattern that really frustrates me. And so there was that. There was also one time, very much milder, but this was very, I'd been seeing him maybe 3 months, and you know, I came in and I'm like, okay, so you know, how much longer till I'm quote normal?
Until I'm fixed.
I'm thinking, I got a couple months, maybe by 6 months, I'm good.
Try not laughing when somebody says that.
And he just goes, oh, yeah, 3 to 5 years. And literally, I didn't even process it without even thinking, just blurted out, fuck you.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and here I am 20 years later, and I've made some improvement. I guess I've made a lot of improvement. That's probably unfair. But I can see that it just never ends. You never, what changes is, the big change that happens if you stick with it long enough is you no longer care how long it takes. You just recognize it. That's what makes life wonderful. And that it's also that you mature out, because the child wants it over. The child like can't, it's like, think of it this way. The person who wants it to be over, that shows your childlike state, because it's like telling, you know, it's December 1st and they start asking when's Christmas. You know, they can't wait the 24 spend 5-3 days till Christmas. Well, that's the same people early in recovery. Well, as you gain maturity and moderation, you start to realize, oh, and you know, you're gonna have days where you feel mature and moderate, and other days you're gonna be there, and who cares? It's just part of, that's what being human and limited is, and that's the reclamation of it, of reclaiming your authentic worth and value, that your inherent worth and value, that at all times, even in those really awful moments, you're always special and you don't need to be any further along than you are than this. But that takes a lot of maturing to grasp hold of.
Self-acceptance.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And if you think about it, you know, problem in your background, who wants to face that? It's no shit. Fun.
Most people don't.
Right.
My experience is different, though. I as hard as I've resisted at times, I've always wanted to, because it just always made me feel better.
Not me.
Okay, next question. And you can answer from the perspective of a coach, and you can answer from the perspective as like a therapist. What do you think are some good questions to ask for someone to figure out whether or not this professional is a good fit for them?
Oh, well. Go ahead, Kenny.
you want to piggyback off me? For me, what I always suggest is, when you talk to a prospective coach or therapist, ask them if they know who PMLD is and her three books. If they don't, to me, if they don't, then you're just, you know, and that to me is a huge red flag if they're not fully invested in PMLD's work. I also believe that they need to be emotion centered, not cognitive centered. Since, you know, every thought, everything we do starts with an emotion. So you'll learn great skills and tools to cover over something, but you won't address the root issue if you're pursuing a cognitive process. I think something that would at least matter to me is, you know, what do they see their style as? Like I said, I needed somebody who could be transparent and share their story. Many coaches and therapists, that's not that, their style. Well, again, so you have to look at yourself and who, what matters to you. But at least from what I've experienced, most of my clients come from people who've been, you know, with psychologists, psychiatrists, therapists, and they haven't found a solution. They haven't been able to get over the top and primarily that's because of those main things. There's no real clear understanding of
who that person is.
Understanding of codependence. There's a lack of relationship within the process, who they worked with. And it was mostly cognitive based, not emotion based. So those have been the things that have shown up the most for me, and why, if you look at my reviews, that's what they point to, is I've spent all this time and money and never, you know, had this progress because none of them dealt with these things. So
yeah, opened up.
Yeah.
Perfect. Mike.
It's harder for me to answer that better than what Kenny just said, but
yeah, it was a good answer.
I don't know that there are questions to ask as much as there are observations to make. Do I feel heard? Does this person seem to want to connect with me? Is the emphasis on, you know, building a trust relationship? I am doing something I haven't done in years, since I started doing neurofeedback. When I started doing neurofeedback, I pretty much set aside my therapy, counseling practice. And, but I now have new patients or new clients. And so it's starting at the beginning with them. And, you know, for me, it's doing a lot of listening and asking a lot of questions and wanting, like, if you were to come in, I'd be asking you questions about yourself. Trying to, for me, actually, to discern, where guidance and direction is going to go. And also because I want to know them, and I want to know what triggers them, and I want to know how they defend themselves. Kenny mentioned cognitive, and I'm not totally sure what he is, because all therapy has a cognitive element in it to some extent. And but is this person experienced? Is this person willing to go with me?
Mm.
You know, do they have, are they handing me a workbook, you know, right away? If they are, work yourself right out of there.
Take that book and get on out.
That's not therapy. I mean, there are places to do that. Mm-hmm. But you have to have a relationship. And I mean, I believe you have to have a relationship. Otherwise, we don't get to the real stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Someone said to me that, you know, the average person quits therapy in 6 weeks.
Wow.
And if you're not committed beyond 6 weeks, you're just not ready. It's not a bad thing about you. You're just not ready to look at what's going on with you. I think it's important that they can talk a little bit about their walk, you know, mm-hmm. how they, and that should come out sort of in a natural way, not like, hey, tell me about your walk. No, do they tell you about themselves? Do they tell you about their walk? Not in a sense of, you know, they're, you know, I need you as a therapist to validate me, not that kind of thing, but, you know, just to communicate real life. I went to a master EMDR therapist. I had an incident and I went to this master guy, wrote books and stuff like that. And he was, you know, really good at EMDR. So we kind of worked through the first issue. And the second issue, I said, well, you know, I have this problem. And at the time it was, you know, I would have thoughts about my wife dying all the time. And he said, well, just don't think about that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I went, and he's, you know, this is in Colorado Springs and he's $275 an hour. And I looked at him, I said, what? And I said, so your response, Mr. Master Therapist, to me is quit doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I'm sorry, I can't work with you. Mm-hmm. And I got up and left.
Mike, you said earlier, I don't know what Kenny means by cognitive. You just displayed it.
Okay.
did that guy ever fall out? Did he ever reach back out or was that it?
No, no.
That's so dangerous. That's fucking dangerous.
Yeah. And he's, you know, like I say, he was highly respected. But not by me, not, you know.
Mike, you know what? May I interrupt?
Please.
Had you, Mike, I think this would be fascinating. Flip the script. What if you were working with someone EMDR and they, you know, doing that, and they said exactly what you said? I think it'd be fascinating to hear the difference between your response and his response. So people get an idea of, oh, that's the juxtaposition of what it's like to, you know, emotion, relationship-based versus cognitive-based. How would you have responded in that situation?
I probably would have reflected back. That sounds really distressing. And can you tell me more about it? And when does this happen? And, you know, I start asking questions. When does this happen? How often does it happen? How have you been dealing with that? That sounds, you know, rough. This, anything to connect, not, you know, what he did is just disconnected. I don't know what his problems were, but I can guess, but.
So to me, that's emotional investment. That's right. Relationship investment. And, right. And that's what.
Or it's just like being like a decent fucking human being. Like, just talking about it. What the fuck?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's scary. Right.
I never, ever, when I walked in that office, expected that I would walk out of that office that way.
Mm. Yeah. It's dangerous.
And I realized that just now. I was thinking, I had a pattern of that. My very first therapist was a analyst. So you went in and you laid on the couch and free associated. And he was a master at it. But by a certain point, you know, he said, what came to your mind? And this guy had a brown shirt on and a goatee. And I said, well, first thing that came to my mind was a goat. He said, really? Can you tell me more about it? And I said, well, he's like a brown goat. And
were you fucking around?
No.
Oh, I wish you were. That would have been this so really, good if you were.
I mean, this really is what I saw. And then it dawned on me that he's the goat.
That's the best
and
story
I said,
ever.
And that goat is you, and I'm out of here. I was like 26, 7, something like that.
Oh, that's great. Do you guys still have a few more minutes for us to talk about neurofeedback? Are you guys going to, you have to head up?
I have 30 more minutes.
Oh, okay. Wonderful. that's so good. Okay. So Kenny, you went somewhere and were doing neurofeedback, and then you came back to Mike and was telling him how effective it was, correct?
Well, no, I found out about it from somebody. He can tell you if he wants that story of who I found out about it from. And I was going...
The goat? From the goat?
No. I went and did it. And I was, you know, going through a lot of stuff with my second marriage that was pretty overwhelming. And I walked into the office and I was a completely different person. And that's when he's like, what'd you do? And, you know, and then I
told him
the story. And it's pretty fascinating how serendipity works and who the person I heard about it from and how he knew her and all of these different things. But he saw such a change in me that he went and lived his message, go become an expert, and that's what he's done.
So he's walked into my office and he's telling me this horrible story But I know the fella, and I'm surprised he's not picking up a chair and throwing it out the window. He wasn't. He was appropriate, moderate, in touch. That's what it seemed like to me. He's since told me that, you know, some of that he wasn't. But it was disturbing because for me, because I was a lot more interested in that story than the story he was telling me. And the story he was telling me is a tragic story. It wasn't a pretty time. And so I finally got to the point, you know, he's talking and you know, this is not being a good therapist necessarily, but I went, what happened? he looked at me like, what? And I'm telling you what happened. I said, no.
What happened to you?
Something's you're different.
And got a haircut or something?
Right. Then he said, well, I was at the golf course and I was talking to the cart girl and she told me I ought to try neurofeedback. And so I did. And I think it's really helping. And I knew where he played golf because I'd gone out with him several times. And I had a friend that I grew up with whose daughter is the only diapers I ever changed. But when she was 15, she had had a psychotic break. Mm-hmm. And I grew up with her dad, and her dad's brother was crazy bipolar. I mean, like, go up on top of the water tower type things, which we did when we were had to go get him when we were teenagers. And so I said, was that girl, I'll call her Andrea. And he goes, how'd you know that? It's like, now I'm the psychic. And I said, well, I know her. And I only just barely knew the story. I knew that they sent her to Dallas to do work with, you know, to do neurofeedback, or that was the term. And I'm not sure I even knew what that was then at all. And so I called my friend. I said, how's your daughter? And he said, well, you know, she had that. We sent her to Dallas. She's never been on medication. She's never had another episode. She's doing great. She's getting her master's. She's going to do neurofeedback. And so where he sent her was to another college roommate's clinic. He didn't see her, but somebody in his clinic did. And so I called him. And neurofeedback is a spectrum of different ways of approaching things. But the most traditional neurofeedback is called single placement or surface neurofeedback. And that's what my friend did. And he about scared me away from it because he said, now, if you're ever dealing with, you know, my dad was bipolar. And so that's why I was in the mental hospital for a long time. But he said, you know, if you ever have somebody's bipolar, never train them at C3, which these are placements that are, it's called the 10-20 system. Anyway, it's just where you have a standard locations for different places on your head. Mm-hmm. And therefore your brain. So never train them at C3. It'll set off a manic episode. I went, what? I don't want to set off a manic episode. And then he said he had a kid came in who had ADHD and he trained him in the wrong spot and he got a tick. Mm. He said, it's no big deal. And in my head, I'm going,
it's a huge deal.
It's a big deal to me. I mean, if this is my kid and I bring him to you, give him something else. He said, we got rid of it. It's no big deal. So that scared me. And so I went back to Kenny and I said, who did you see? And I went and met with her. And she actually did a cue on me and we did a session. And she's really nice. She really encouraged me. And it was a different perspective, a different way of doing neurofeedback. And which is a, a lot of terms for it, but, you know, whole head training, we're training more than, you know, just surface locations and, you know, it's all compared to normative database. So it's Z scored is what it's called. And so that became the direction I wanted to go because it was safer. I ended up within a month or so meeting Dr. Joel Lubar, who may be in his last days on the earth right now. Mm-hmm. He's in hospice. But Dr. Lubar was he was the first person to do neurofeedback with the general public. And he had a lab and a clinic at University of Tennessee, Knoxville, which is where I grew up, as you know. And he first started working with kids that had seizures, and he did the same kind of protocols that started neurofeedback by a guy named Dr. Barry Sturman. And then he went on to, you know, develop other, you know, focuses, ADHD. He was, you know, the guy who wrote those protocols and depression and dyslexia. And what's pretty unique about Joel is that as technology advanced, he did too. Whereas there are a lot of guys that are older that are still
stuck in their ways. Yeah.
Right. They're still doing, and to be honest with you, when I started this, I thought it would be easier the way they were doing it. It was, you know, partly because the software was, you know, you have depression, you push depression, you know, that kind of thing. But turned out I ended up having to learn so much more about the brain, how it works, and ended up doing neuroanatomy at Duke Medical School. Other things, and it just, you know, as Joel began to teach me, you know, I just realized that, you know, his little fingernail knows more than I'll ever know about any of all this. He's a brilliant man, and it's just been awesome. So this is a whole different way of doing things, and we mentioned QEG. It's also all based on QEG and QEG stands for quantitative analysis, and most neurologists do what is called qualitative analysis. I can do both and do both, but at a certain point, because of my credentials, I have to stop and send them to a neurologist or send them to another professional if I see certain things in their EEG. And I don't know where else to go.
Well, can we explain the process? Like, and let's say, for example, for somebody like my audience, right, is like childhood trauma, complex PTSD. How does the process work and why is it effective?
For the client, basically, it doesn't really matter what you do, what kind of neurofeedback you do, if you do in single placement or what I do, which is, a normal protocol that we do has got, you know, somewhere between 700 and 1,000 different metrics that we're trying to change at once. And, okay. And it's micro changes. And it's one of the reasons that it's safe because it's going, you know, it's addressing different factors in the brain and it's all over. And so we're doing little baby changes and that doesn't have as much of possible negative impact. We don't really have side effects.
What is an example of a metric?
A metric would be I place one electrode right here. And by the way, electrode is a sensor. It's not, I mean, there are STEM techniques, but we're reading the brain. We're not sending anything in.
Okay.
And basically, we use operant conditioning. So an example of operant conditioning is it can be sound. So if you hear the sound, you're in the zone and you learn to make that sound. or it can be a picture. You know, if the graph goes up, you're in the zone. And so you learn to get in the zone. That's how it initially started, was something very similar like that. We use movies, you know, and, you know, that kind of stuff. So for them to see the movie clearly, they have to be doing the protocol, or they have to be addressing the protocol. So they can't, you know, just sit there and fall asleep. But at the same time, they can't sit there and try like crazy to score, because that counter, you know, that's a counter move for that. So their part is relatively easy as long as they are willing to try to relax and enjoy the movie. Our part, what's different is our part is a lot more complex. And creating the protocols that will work for you, it's not working for everybody, it's for you. Mm-hmm. And that's basically what QEG does. QEG is a way of looking at different metrics. This again is a different metric than this one here, but looking at, you know, specific things in the brain. How is the brain communicating? Is it clear? Is it unclear? If it's unclear, is it hypersynchronized or which means it's stuck going one direction, basically in a rut? And if so, you know, what we can do is break that up, and then you can differentiate different sources and respond differently as opposed to respond the same way. An example of that is, you know, like a PTSD type trigger. You're in the present. Something happens. It reminds you of the past. What do? You go back to the past, not necessarily cognitively, but mm-hmm. emotionally mm-hmm. and sometimes physically, right? Mm-hmm. And so, and that's because there's a circuit that's basically, you know, wired up in such a way, it just responds the same way every time. That's what neurofeedback, when I did it, changed for me. I never had the ability to not get triggered. But about 6 months after I did neurofeedback, I kept running into situations that I knew historically had triggered me, and I'm cool, calm, and collected, and I'm moderate. I'm responsive, not reactive, and that's because somehow we broke up that hyper circuit. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
In the brain, so that, you know. I now had the freedom for my brain to respond in a healthy way instead of a PTSD way.
So when you're in session, if we're like working with a particular trigger, I mean, are we having that person think of that, and then we're like teaching them like how to handle it, or?
The answer is yes and no. It depends on how you're approaching it. And, you know, with some people, they can't help but focus on it.
Yeah.
And so there has to be some kind of integration of therapy with it. I mentioned Saberne Fisher, and, you know, Saberne Fisher is just a masterful therapist. I mean, and she works with the hardest of the hardest in terms of population, people with severely attached attachment disorder and super complex PTSD. And she has protocol interventions that she does, you know, with electrodes on the brain that can calm somebody down really fast. But that's not, you know, that's an intervention. That's not neurofeedback, because neurofeedback is a learning process. It's a training process. And we train the brain to respond in a normal and healthy way. And when that happens, then they have symptom relief.
Okay.
So we don't pick a trigger necessarily. Now she might, I don't really know, but it's not a crisis intervention therapy either, in my opinion. I've had people come in and they're just in super crisis. They need to go to counseling, and they need to get some kind of sense of wholeness so that they're not always in crisis. Now, we can do that together, and we can lower that level of, you know, hypervigilance or whatever, you know, is keeping them constantly in crisis. But does that make sense?
It does. What about like the somatic piece? Like, because obviously we have this stored trauma in the body. Do you feel like the neurofeedback is addressing that, or that has to be another component that, you know, to do the somatic work?
It's probably both in. Mm-hmm. You know, the brain is a marvelous thing, and the brain is connected to the body. And it's got feedback systems from within the body. There's an area called the insula in the brain that has connections with every internal organ. And actually that's a rather new, it's like been in the last 10 years that they've discovered that. But so there, it's not necessarily an intended result, but oftentimes we have people that do have things locked up in their body, or they're, you know, we have people that come in that are just flat out sick. And, you know, some of them had surgeries and all kinds of stuff. Somehow we're able to fix that with most people. So it can be both and. It can be, you know, I have some clients that have a lot of somatic stuff. We send them somebody that does specializes, or I do that work with them as well. Does that answer your question?
Uh-huh. So what is like the prep work look like for something like that? And how quickly are you seeing results with people?
Well, compared to talk therapy, it's really, really fast. So our process is you would come in, see us, we would acquire EEG from your brain. EEG stands for electroencephalography. I can hardly say it. And then that's when I got to work on it. I do a full assessment of looking at the raw EEG and looking for specific things like transients and paroxysms that could be dangerous. And which by the way, there aren't that many people who do that do neurofeedback. There are people that do neurofeedback who have no training. That's, you know, that's can be a problem because the general public doesn't know that. Mm-hmm. But then we do quantitative analysis, and we're looking at a comparison between a normative database and what's out of norm. And that's how our stuff trains. We train from out of norm into norm, whereas traditional neurofeedback trained frequencies.
Okay.
And so, like when Barry Sternman started, he was asked by NASA to help the astronauts because they were having seizures because they were exposed to rocket fuel. He found a frequency, 12 to 15 hertz. If they got in that zone, they didn't have seizures anymore, and they slept like babies and their brain stabilized. That's traditional neurofeedback. We do that in our process. We do train frequencies, but it's just much, much more, and not specifically just 12 to 15 hertz, that kind of thing. And I know that probably doesn't make any sense to you. But I mean, really, if you're in good hands with people, I go through what I see, usually blind. Like I look at the data and I talk to you and I tell you what I see. And you struggle with this, and this. And this is how we're going to attack it. Then they pick their movie and we start, you know, attacking it. And we're training the brain. And it's not a treatment, because 90%+ of the people that come see us, when they leave us, they don't have that anymore. And that's another thing that Dr. Lubar, he did longitudinal studies a year later, 5 years later, 10 years later, 20 years later. And these people had learned not to have that problem. But, you know, like their brain got taught and the brain learned it and continued that. And so they don't have symptoms down the road either. It's, and that's why we call it training. Whereas a treatment is like, you know, some kind of stim or a drug. You know, you quit taking it, it quits working, right? This isn't the way neurofeedback is. You asked about timing. Our average, 70% of our clients do 30 sessions, and it's twice a week, so that's 15 weeks, and they're done. Then we have another 20% that have to do 40, and another 10% that have to do 50 or more. Depends. We see a lot of complex things, so there's a lot of comorbidity to what, you know, why they're coming. They got PTSD, they've got depression, they've got an anxiety disorder, and some kind of irritable bowel syndrome, you know, or something like that. So, you know, there's multiple things that are going on.
What was the process like for you, Kenny?
You go in, the assessment is, if I remember correct, 10 minutes with your eyes closed and then 10 minutes with your eyes open. And that's the scanning of your brain to see. The way I liken it is, think of your brain having millions of electrical wires that are all supposed to be interconnected. And basically, some of those wires don't connect where they're supposed to. And that's why you're experiencing this dysregulation of all different kind. Well, neurofeedback reconnects those wires so that your brain talks to itself the right way. So that's what the initial assessment figures out is, okay, what wires have been pulled out of their socket that we need to put back together? Once they figure that out, they go, okay, well, these are the areas that, you know, this is why you're experiencing these feelings or these things. So this is the type of training we're going to do. And then it's simple. You just show up, and I would always watch Boston Legal. And for me, some people need to focus, because what happens is when your brain is training correctly, the screen stays fully, you know, you can view the full screen and you get the full sound. When your brain drops out of training, the screen starts to shrink in and the sound starts to disappear. Some people, you know, need to focus, like they go, okay, and they really pay attention. They can keep the screen open and the sound going. I was the opposite. I had to focus on what's going on in the show. That's it. The less I was hypervigilant, and tried to control things, because that's always been my issue. And I just, you know, it's like I talk about in my first book, how to let life come. Like, I had to learn how to stop controlling. And so, you know, I would see the screen start to shrink. And then my focus became on, okay, what did he just say? What does everyone look like? What's the feeling going on? Like, I got myself present to the show and everything would open back up. That's how I did it. And you know, sometimes there were certain training protocols where, you know, I felt like there was this fog. I was so my brain was exhausted and I'd have to sleep a lot, you know. But mostly you just walk in and out and you're like, yeah, whatever, I don't know. And the next thing you know, like Mike said, I walk into his office and going through this hell, but I'm like, yeah, whatever. You know, I mean, that it's very non-invasive, you know, there's not a lot of side effects. I mean, you know, certain things Mike could speak to, there might, you know, something gets triggered here or there, but that's very rare. It's very simple, very easy. It's not painful. You don't experience a lot of emotional aspects to it. You just sit and watch something. Mm-hmm. And it sort of, your brain just naturally learns how to do what it was meant to do, and things start getting reconnected, and all of a sudden you're able to live life a lot easier. It's like I said, everyone's always searching for a magic pill. Pot is the big thing now, psychedelics, all of these different things, you know, medications that people want to take so that they can subvert the process of doing the work. And the only thing I've ever seen that comes close to a magic pill is neurofeedback.
And then has been my experience as a clinician. What I've normally said, it, you know, is that in counseling, I saw people get substantial healing. Okay. They did leave better than when they came. But it wasn't like a complete healing. You know, they still had, you know, a lot of them still were on medication for depression and or whatever. They had learned coping skills, which is what counseling does. With neurofeedback, I had full remission. You know, people don't have an anxiety disorder or depression or PTSD when they leave. And and again, some of it depends on the complexity of the case, but you know, it doesn't work for everybody, but it works for most. And it's really pretty. I mean, it's so powerful to see somebody's life totally changed in that shorter period, and they know it.
Yeah.
And I mean, I can tell you story after story after story after story. And
you can read a lot of those stories on my website. You know, Mike's been gracious enough. You know, there's a couple pages dedicated to Mike about neurofeedback, Mike himself, where he shares a lot of that. So
I'll include that in the show notes for sure.
Yeah.
Well, this has been so fun for me. What do you want to promote anything, Mike? Where your office, your practice is in Colorado?
Yes, in Colorado Springs, where it's called Heart Matters. And yeah, that's, I don't know what else to tell you. We're in North Colorado Springs. We're off of North Gate, which for Colorado people, that is obvious because it's the North Gate of the Academy, which is a big deal.
Anything else you want to plug, Kenny?
No, just
no.
Yeah. One thing's happened. I'm sorry, Kenny. Just walked right over you. When we did our own little podcast thing, I got calls from people in, you know, Nebraska or Arizona or wherever. I can't do neurofeedback remotely. Sure.
Mm-hmm.
They need to know that. I can help advise them on finding a clinician because I'm also on the board of the International QEG Certification Board. So I know I have access to clinicians. So.
Okay. Good to know. So, well, thank you, gentlemen.
I'm sorry.
Kenny, you want to say something?
No, that's important for people to know. Yeah, I mean, I guess what I'd promote is my website. It is a treasure trove of
it sure is. I spent some time
free content, links to countless things, whether they want something for free or they want to dig a little deeper and purchase my books or take my classes or hire me. If you know, I've tried to set up as a one-stop Google shop. There's even that feature Ask Kenny where you can type in any question. It pulls from all of my content,
solutions cool.
immediately. And then
AI.
Yeah, it's an AI program where we've loaded in that's everything so cool. I've ever said or written. You type in a question, how do I deal with so-and-so spouse? And it'll give you solutions that I've talked about and then give you the bibliography of what video, what book, whatever it is I've spoken about it. So you can dig deeper. So, and then, you know, those are for, you know, people looking for, you know, things in the beginning to see if they, you know, I always say pick someone you know, like, and trust. It gives you a chance to get to know me, see if you like me. And then if you feel that you trust me, then you can, you know, purchase books or book a session or take classes or whatever. But it at least gives you an introduction and hopefully some solutions that are helpful to you.
So, well, this has been a pleasure, gentlemen. Thanks so much for everything.
Thank you for letting me be a part of it.